I'm Rick Howard, and welcome to Santa Monica, California. I moved in here over 20 years ago, and shortly after that, I began a career of making travel adventure documentaries around the world. I started working in Southeast Asia. My first film was the Philippines. And then over the years, I went on to Thailand, Indonesia, Malaysia, Singapore. But I learned early on that the most inexpensive way to get to that part of the world was through Hong Kong. In other words, if I wanted to fly to Manila in the Philippines or Bangkok, Thailand, it was cheaper to go through Hong Kong than it was to fly direct from here. So I went through Hong Kong quite a few times, each time spending a couple of days and shooting a little bit of film. But then I began working in the islands of the Pacific, Hawaii, Tahiti, Fiji. I didn't get back to Hong Kong for about 12 years. When I did return, I was amazed to see how much the place had grown and changed in that period of time. So I decided to finish the film now, not only about Hong Kong, but also many of the outer islands, some of which are tropical paradises. And I ultimately wanted to get up into southern China, to an area known as Guilin, where I found the most beautiful natural scenery that I've ever seen. So that's going to be our story. I hope you enjoy the real world of Hong Kong and southern China. We're just taking off from the Anchorage, Alaska airport here. My first trip to Hong Kong cost $195 round trip. Very special deal, though. That was the only time I've ever been able to fly that inexpensively. And I did have to go through Anchorage, but it was worth it. Hong Kong has been called a pearl in the ear of old China. It's also been called a beggar on the doorstep for the largest communist country in the world. The words Hong Kong mean fragrant harbor. Victoria Harbor separates Hong Kong Island from the Kowloon Peninsula. The aerial approach to Hong Kong is one of the most beautiful in the world, so the pilots will usually fly you all the way around the island before landing. It gives everybody a chance to see everything. As soon as you land here, you realize that you've entered a very watery world, a world of islands and boats. The little boat there is called a sampan, and these are the water taxis that transport people all over this area. They have so much water around here that they probably have as many water taxis as the four-wheel kind. Many people here live a floating existence. They live on these large boats, and the little sampans provide transportation between them. Hong Kong is the most densely populated island in the world. It's also a place where the old world and the new come together. The romantic old Star Ferry can get you across Victoria Harbor to Hong Kong Island. Please do not spit. They don't want you spitting on the Star Ferry. They also have one of the most modern and efficient subway systems anywhere in the world. It's another way to get from the Kowloon Peninsula where you land under Victoria Harbor out to Hong Kong Island. You can be in many parts of downtown Hong Kong and you might feel as though you're in San Francisco or London or any other international city. That's until you look up one of the windy little roads in the old Wan Chai district. You can see the way Hong Kong has looked for about a century. The most densely populated place in the world. On Hong Kong Island and the neighboring communities, 6 million people live together in these tiny pieces of land. This is the old Wan Chai district, the oldest part of town. It's also the Suzy Wong district of 1940s and 50s fame. When you first arrive here, the hustle and bustle and the human energy is a little bit intimidating at first until you get used to the crowds. Here's the future. Not only for Hong Kong, but many of the other places out here. Education. You can always see school children coming and going from school in uniform. Due to their modern advancements in technology, places like Hong Kong, Taiwan, Korea, and Japan have really taken the business world by storm in the last few decades. So now you have some of the wealthiest people in the world living side by side with some of the poorest on this tiny speck of land. Hong Kong is a land of diversity. and China is a land of harsh realities. I'm going to show you a few things that might shock you, like this. But no sooner will you see something like that, you'll turn your head and see something else that will enchant you. It all just goes with the neighborhood. You're also going to see some of the cutest children you've ever seen in your life. China's full of them. There are more Chinese in the world than anybody else. And the power and energy that runs this whole place is the almighty dollar. I've never seen such money-conscious people in my life. Here's a look back into the past, the little rickshaws that used to transport people around. Today, the rickshaw drivers prefer to nap in the sun, maybe have their picture taken with you. If you pay one of them enough, he'll huff and puff you down around the business central district of Hong Kong. This is no longer a cost-effective way to travel. They cost more than the taxis. But it's worth at least one ride to see what it must have felt like in the old days. This is downtown central Hong Kong, the business center. It's also the first part of Hong Kong that was settled by the British back in the early 1840s. Nobody really lives downtown. It's for business only. Most people live in the surrounding areas. And most of them live in public housing. Hong Kong has the largest and most successful public housing project to be found anywhere in the world. Of the 6 million people that live here, fully one half of them live in some kind of government-subsidized public housing. Everything that you're looking at is public housing. That's how you get 6 million people in such a small place. The best place to see the city of Hong Kong is from up on top of Victoria Peak. You get quite a view of the whole city and the Kowloon Peninsula on the other side of the harbor there from here. And this is Hong Kong today, but it hasn't always looked like this. About 100 years ago, Hong Kong looked like this. And about 150 years ago, it looked like this. They said that Hong Kong was a barren rock without a human structure on it, but it was very attractive to the British. The British needed a colony, a seaport out here where they could trade with the Chinese and get out from under the very expensive trade rules of the Hussongs. Hong Kong foot the bill. So a community sprung up here in one season. There was a tenuous relationship between the British and the Chinese in the beginning. The British didn't really like Hong Kong Island. There was nothing on it. Now, what they wanted was Victoria Harbor. If you notice, Victoria Harbor has a very unique S shape. That means if you're anchored in a ship in the center of that harbor, you're protected on all four sides by land, protected from the terrible typhoons that rage through this part of the world every year. It was the most perfectly shaped natural harbor in Asia, and the British wanted it. And they acquired it through some very unorthodox methods. It was tough in the early days. For example, disease was quite a problem. Back then, they believed that malaria was caused by poison gases that were released from certain parts of the earth in the summertime. As we know today, malaria is actually carried by certain varieties of mosquito. But they didn't know that back then. In that first season, the malaria epidemic decimated the ranks of the British Navy and the Hong Kong population. Yeah, life in old Hong Kong was tough, but not as tough as it was up in the Chinese mainland. Disease, starvation, bandits, pirates, civil war were all very common up here. And the punishments for crimes were horrendous. This was one of the punishments for piracy. And this was a punishment for smuggling. And you were never released here. You stayed in this contraption until you died. These factors, among many others, caused the first big wave of human population heading south for the more lenient rule of the British in Hong Kong. Some of the wealthy Chinese came too with some interesting customs. For example, an upper-class woman had to have a foot-binding ceremony when she was a teenager. A bandage that was 1 inch wide and 12 feet long was wrapped around the heel, over the instep, and up under the arch of the foot, pulling the toes closer to the heel, creating a 4 inch long foot for a fully grown woman. Painful for the rest of her life, but necessary if she was in the upper class. These customs were appalling to the British when they arrived here, but no more appalling than the British customs were to the Chinese. For example, the British introduced opium here for the purposes of trade, and in a short period of time, they were addicting the population of southern China to this drug. The British were bringing the opium in under the protection of the British Navy. And over the years, through the opium trade, they managed to acquire Hong Kong Island, the neighboring islands, and finally the new territories here in light green, all on the south coast of China. Now, why opium? Well, the British needed tea, silk, and porcelain from the Chinese. The only thing that the Chinese would accept for these goods was silver bullion. And even though a few British merchants were becoming very wealthy, they were bankrupting the British economy. They needed a new product. That product turned out to be opium. They could harvest these opium poppies in India through their Dutch East India Company, take the opium to Hong Kong, sell it for silver bullion, buy the tea, silk, and porcelain, and take the goods back to England, then back to India for more opium. This triangular trade route was established, and vast fortunes were amassed in a short period of time. But as I said, they were addicting the population of the southern part of this country to this drug. This was a romantic time in history, though, the time of the Taipan traders, when swift China clipper ships like this one would make the race from Hong Kong to England. The company owning the ships that arrived first would get the best prices for their goods. This is also the subject of James Clavell's novel, Taipan. Well, today Hong Kong has one foot in the past, one foot in the present, and both eyes on the future. Like an Aberdeen fishing village on the south coast of Hong Kong, Aberdeen is a fascinating world within a world, an entire floating community. The people live here on the large junks, and the little sandpans provide transportation. Well, about 150 years ago, the Chinese emperor decided that this addiction of his people to opium had to end. So they had sort of a Boston Tea Party of their own. The Chinese threw a fortune worth of British opium overboard, costing the Taipans a fortune and infuriating the British government, which immediately declared war on China. They called this the First Opium War. It lasted for about 2 weeks, and the British easily won the war. They demanded Hong Kong Island in war reparations. Then 20 years later, they had the Second Opium War for exactly the same reason with exactly the same results. This time, the British demanded the neighboring islands. But then 30 years later, they had another treaty, this time without a war, and the Chinese did better for themselves this time. They actually gave a large expanse of land called the New Territories to the British, but on a 99-year lease. Well, July 1st, 1997, the lease expired, and the People's Republic of China regained custody of Hong Kong, the neighboring islands, and everything out here. The opium trade still exists, but it no longer comes from India nor through the British. Now the opium comes from the steaming jungles of the Golden Triangle, where Thailand, Laos, and Burma all come together. The opium is grown by the villagers up here and controlled by the mercenary armies and their warlords. The opium is harvested up here every winter and carried down out of these mountains in mule trains. A few weeks later, the opium will be entering harbors all over Southeast Asia. Aberdeen is one of them. But Aberdeen is also one of the most popular tourist attractions on Hong Kong Island. Every day, people from all over the world will come out here to take a sandpan ride out among the floating community of Aberdeen. This is also some vintage footage. This was shot more than 20 years ago. Aberdeen has changed a little bit in these days. Unfortunately, in my opinion, they've cleaned it up a little bit. It lost some of its magic and charm. Back at this time, some of the elderly people here never touched dry land their entire lives. They lived their lives floating on the junks due to an ancient feud between the Chinese emperor and the rulers of the sea. What in many parts of the world is considered to be superstition, in China is often considered to be religion. They have fortune tellers in all the temples, and they believe that there's a spirit in almost everything. The mountains, the trees, the rocks, the sea, everything has a spirit. Even wood. So the builders here won't touch metal scaffolding. They feel that if they tie their bamboo scaffolding together like this, that spirit will save a life, as long as they don't put any nails into the wood. If anybody falls, there will always be a piece of bamboo to reach out and grab, thanks to that spirit. So everything is tied together. And no matter how tall the buildings or signs are, they look like this when they're going up. Most people get their fortunes told every day. Here's one of the methods. You don't want to build your house on the head or the neck of an underground sleeping dragon, disturbing his sleep and causing him to bring bad luck to your home. This little pathway along the top of Victoria Peak used to be the only road up here. This was back at a time when the wealthy were carried up here in sedan chairs like this. And once the colony was established, it became a lucrative life for a few British merchants. The Peak Tram was built in the last century. It still operates today. It's a way to get to the top of Victoria Peak in about 10 minutes. Tiger Bomb Gardens, started by a couple of brothers that invented a medicated salve called Tiger Bomb. They became so wealthy in this enterprise that they built the Tiger Bomb Gardens as a gift for the people of Hong Kong, as a thank you for making them so rich. And these are the people of Hong Kong today, young and old, rich and poor, living together on these tiny pieces of land. The laundry out the window they call the International Flags of Hong Kong. Some of these buildings are so narrow that they have to be braced to keep them standing. And any time you have this many old buildings so close together, fire is a constant threat. My first trip here, they had a big fire down in the old Wan Chai district. The whole city filled up with smoke. Terrifying for the people that live down there, but they put this fire out. About 40 years earlier, they weren't so lucky. December 7th, 1941, the same day the Japanese bombs were raining down on Pearl Harbor, they were also falling on Hong Kong. The Japanese were here, and the very relaxed life of the British ended overnight. There was a bloody battle and a siege that lasted for more than 2 weeks. Then on Christmas Day, 1941, the Japanese invaded the island, capturing Hong Kong and imprisoning the Chinese and British population. The very brutal way in which the Japanese treated their prisoners of war is well documented. Mass executions, tortures of all kind were common daily. But the Chinese and British population weathered the storm. And as we know, the Japanese lost that war. So after signing the instrument of surrender, Hong Kong returned to what it had been for so long, the last British colony in the world. We're going to leave Hong Kong Island now to visit some of the outlying areas. The hydrofoil there can take you out to Macau, a Portuguese community. The hydrofoils are the fastest way of getting around here, and they really only go out to Macau. The ride on a hydrofoil is more like a plane trip than a boat ride. The only part of the boat touching the water is that lower foil. The rest of the boat is suspended above the water. It's about 40 miles from Hong Kong out to Macau, but these hydrofoils can get you out there in about an hour. First, you'll wind your way around the islands near Hong Kong. Then you'll cross the large expanse of water at the mouth of the enormous Pearl River, one of the ancient routes up into China, until you reach Macau, right there. The hovercraft can also take you out to Macau. They're not quite as fast as the hydrofoils, but they're much faster than the big ferries, which also come out here daily. And now, in Macau, you're on a border with the People's Republic of China. Just down the other side of that barbed wire fence is the largest communist country in the world. Also, the only gambling casinos you find here are in Macau. And Macau is the only place where you can buy fireworks and firecrackers. They've been illegalized over in Hong Kong because of the fire danger. I saw incense burning everywhere that day, and I found out that it was here for religious purposes. There are three main religions in China: Buddhism, Confucianism, and Taoism. Well, the Tao is really the only homegrown Chinese religion, started by a prophet named Louza about 2,500 years ago. Louza was supposedly conceived by a shooting star which somehow got lodged in the womb of his unfortunate mother, who had to carry him for more than 80 years. Finally, Louza was born as an old man with gray hair. But the faith that he established wasn't so far-fetched. He taught that there was a beautiful balance in the universe, a yin and a yang, a good and a bad, a positive and a negative, and only if you could find your proper positive place in that balance would you be living the life that God meant for you. Eventually, Louza climbed on a water buffalo and took off toward Tibet seeking solitude. But before he left, he managed to create a beautiful faith that's lasted for more than 2,500 years. Here's the yo-yo boy of Macau. When the Portuguese first arrived here more than 300 years ago, they realized instantly they were setting up shop in a very hostile part of the world. So early on, they built a fort on some high ground in the center of the city. They built this fort with cannons pointing out on all four sides facing the sea as a warning to any pirates or bandits that might want to try their luck and rob Macau. The windy cobblestone roads take you back centuries to when this colony was established. On the way back to Hong Kong in the hydrofoil, I saw three eagles flying around outside. I asked the Chinese woman sitting next to me what kind of eagles those were, and she looked at me like a dumb American and said, "They're Chinese eagles." Then she said, "They're fighting. Watch. Two males fighting over a female. Many eagles mate for life, so sometimes the mating ritual involves combat. She waits below while her two suitors fight it out above. These fishing eagles are very common here. You see them every day around Hong Kong." Well, I got back to Hong Kong that evening just about the time that the sun was going down. And the next morning, I decided to take a lunch boat. These lunch and dinner boats are very common here. They travel around Hong Kong every day and into the night. These boats are big and bigger and very comfortable. You can be cruising around Hong Kong in comfort, having a nice meal, while you're looking out the window at a much different sight, like the shanty towns clinging to the cliffs of Hong Kong Island. This again is a look back into the past. Back in 1949, when the Communist Revolution took place here, many of the Chinese didn't want to live under the communist regime. So thousands of them escaped, swimming more than 18 miles to Hong Kong. Thousands died during the swim. This was another big wave of human population heading south. Well, the refugees that survived the swim set up house anywhere they could possibly find. Naturally, there was no good land available, so they had to live where nobody else wanted to, on these cliffs. They were ineligible for the public housing since they had actually come here without any legal travel documents. They were illegal aliens, so they're still stuck here today. Actually, the real tragedy is during the typhoon season every year. The typhoons come and thousands of these shanty towns have washed away over the last couple decades, killing thousands of people. But up in China, things have started to change, to a great extent due to the efforts of Richard Nixon. Since 1979, the Chinese have opened their borders to the outside world, allowing, under some strict rules, for us to come up and visit them and for some of their people to come out and visit us. This was one of the border crossings almost 20 years ago. These border crossings have changed quite a bit now, as you'll see later on. There are many ways to get across Victoria Harbor and through the Kowloon Peninsula up into the new territories. There are trains, buses, and private cars that will take you up here daily. And once you get up into the new territories, you seem to have gone back into a time machine, into a place that looks like old China. China, a fascinating empire more than 5,000 years old. The Chinese invented gunpowder, the compass, the printing press, paper. They dug the longest canal in the world and built the longest wall in the world. And they had a very civilized society when the people of Western Europe were barely out of the caves. But even the new territories are changing. Everything that you're looking at now, today, has had public housing built here. Water sports have become very popular in the last couple decades, primarily because there's so much water. Sports like windsurfing, parasailing, big game fishing, and scuba diving have all really taken off here. Like at Repulse Bay, on the south coast of Hong Kong Island, a beautiful beach resort named after the HMS Repulse, a pirate-chasing ship of the last century. A feng shui gentleman told them that there was a slumbering dragon in that mountain back there. So if they wanted to build a building here, they had to leave a window in it so the dragon could see the sea. There's a religious shrine at Repulse Bay. And this is Confucius. One of the three main faiths here is Confucianism. Confucius was a government official that lived about 2,500 years ago, and he established more of a philosophy than a religion. At 51 years of age, Confucius realized his spiritual calling and spent many years traveling all over China teaching rulers how to properly organize their governments. He taught that government needed to be organized according to equitable means. Honor was the most important thing, the maintaining and saving of face. If you had no honor, you had nothing worth having. And even today, more than 2,500 years later, if you're a government official in China, you pretty much have to be an expert on what Confucius said. They're still using his standards today. There's the Jumbo Floating Restaurant, the largest floating restaurant in the world. There's actually three big ones here at Aberdeen Fishing Village. The Jumbo's the biggest. It's really many restaurants in one. There's not a lot of activity here during the day. This is mainly a place to come at night. But tonight, thousands of people from all over the world will be dining in luxury in these enormous dining rooms. When the sun gets low in the western sky, this place begins to take on a magical feeling. Repulse Bay is one of the places known for its sunsets. So I've time-lapsed one of the sunsets here so you can see the whole sunset. You can also see what the world looks like moving 100 times faster than normal. Here's an American couple on their honeymoon. They're on their way to the Jumbo Floating Restaurant for dinner. Making these movies, I've been able to see beautiful sunsets all over the world. But I've never seen sunsets more romantic than the ones that I saw on the south coast of China. And if those floating restaurants are impressive during the day, after dark, they become spectacularly beautiful. Thousands of people dining in luxury in these jeweled floating palaces, reflecting in the water. Trip, I was lucky enough to be here during Chinese New Year's. Kung Hei Fat Choi means Happy New Year, and this was the year of the cock, so they had neon roosters on all the buildings. And what would a Chinese New Year's be without lion dances and dragon dances? You find them daily in the streets and the shopping malls, and they're held for the sake of maintaining good luck. Good luck is an important part of Chinese philosophy and religion. Now, this is a lion dance, and these are supposed to be lions. There's two men in each costume. The man in the front operates that enormous head, and the man in the rear has his head buried in the rear of the man in the front. These dances are always accompanied by a percussion group just off stage there. Now obviously, in this position, the man in the rear especially can't see very much. But still, look what they managed to do. We're on our way up into the new territories again, passing a poultry farm. With all the hungry people in Hong Kong, there's quite a few poultry farms here in the new territories. Up in the new territories, the Sung Dynasty village, built for the purpose of teaching tourists about old China, at a time when the Manchu form of government was in power here, much like the European feudal system. The country was controlled by the emperor from behind the walls of the Forbidden City in Beijing, and he controlled his country through his mandarins. Mandarins were like governors. They controlled large expanses of land. They had armies to protect their land. Out in the countryside, life among the peasants was dirt poor. But this is what life looked like in the palaces of the mandarins. But this was a very oppressive form of government, and it was destined to be overthrown by secret societies called tongs or triads, organized by the Chinese. They overthrew the Manchus by about the 1850s. But the secret societies didn't disappear. In many ways, they become China's modern form of organized crime. Chinese acrobats have been very famous all over the world for many years. And they have two very good shows here each day at the Sung Dynasty Village. To me, the most amazing thing about this human pyramid is that the one on the bottom holding everybody else up was the only girl in the act. Now watch her break the law of gravity here. He'll fill the cups up with water, and she won't spill a drop. Dancers from northern and southern China will perform here daily. Yeah, a trip out to the Sung Dynasty village is a very colorful experience. To me, the most impressive performer that day was this guy, a kung fu master. Now that's a razor-sharp, triple-bladed spearhead on the end of that spear, and without ever touching the spear with his hands, he manages this amazing juggling act. In slow motion, you can really see what he's doing here. That razor-sharp spearhead is flashing by only inches from his face. Yeah, at least one trip out to the Sung Dynasty village is a must for anybody coming here. You can get out here from Hong Kong in about 20 minutes on a bus or a train, and you can see the whole thing in about a half a day. There are many other things up in the new territories to see as well. And one of the ways to get under Victoria Harbor is the tunnel that was built quite a few years ago, in addition to the subways and the Star Ferry. And these are my first trips to Hong Kong. But as I mentioned, back then I was really only going through Hong Kong to do other jobs in other countries. On this particular trip, I was on my way down to the Philippines to finish an underwater film job that I had started there a year earlier. Like the aerial approach, the aerial departure from Hong Kong is also one of the most beautiful in the world. But this was my last trip to Southeast Asia for more than 12 years. I spent the next few years working in the South Pacific, places like Hawaii, Tahiti, and Fiji. I didn't return to Hong Kong until just a few years ago. And I was amazed to see the change. This is Hong Kong in the early 1960s. None of the buildings back there are higher than 10 stories. But here's Hong Kong now at night. Some of the buildings are as tall as Victoria Peak in the background. Reminded me very much of New York City. And coincidentally, I'd arrived back again exactly 12 years later, which meant once again it was Chinese New Year's, and once again it was the Year of the Cock. They have 12 animals altogether. There's the Year of the Cock, the dog, the pig, the horse, the snake, and so on, 12 of them. So every 12 years it rotates around again to the Year of the Cock. And the neon art on the buildings was more impressive than it had been. Some of these decorations were 20, 30 stories high. Imagine the electric bill. Down in the old Wan Chai district, things haven't changed in the better part of a century. But even in Wan Chai, when you look at the skyline, you can see the new city growing. Hong Kong is a very expensive place to live. The apartments downtown cost a fortune. And if you want a parking place downtown Central, you have to buy the parking place for life. A good one will cost you about $75,000 for a place to park your car. We're leaving Hong Kong now, and we're going to visit Hong Kong's closest neighboring island, the island of Lama. These neighboring islands are much more rural, with an old Chinese feeling, than Hong Kong. There's only a couple of small communities on Lama. And even though these towns are much smaller than Hong Kong, some of them are much older. The narrow little windy roads here remind one of a time before cars, when rickshaws and sedan chairs were the only way of getting around. And also, Lama is a good place for hiking. There's a hiking trail in Lama that will go from one village up over the top of the mountain down to the fishing village in the other side of the island. These hiking trails are well kept through the jungle, and you can pass places like Cave Kamikaze. These caves are common here. And back during the Second World War, many of the Allied resistance fighters fought the Japanese from hiding in these caves for years. The other village is a fishing village, and like most fishing villages, it's surrounded by fishing boats. Many people in the fishing villages live on their boats. They only come ashore for the necessities found there. This particular village is a restaurant center. During the weekend, hundreds of people will be dining here. But during the week, it's a little bit more quiet, so some of the restaurant employees take this opportunity to play mahjong. This game is a Chinese addiction. It's a form of gambling, and they play it every chance they get. We're on our way now to Ocean Park. And the only way to get out to Ocean Park is this amazing cable car system. From the cable car, you can get a very impressive view of the south coast of Hong Kong. Aquatic parks like this are very common in the west, but they're not very common in the east, and this is the biggest one out here. Most of the aquatic exhibits are underground. On the surface, there's an amusement park with rides for the kids. They also have one of the most impressive dolphin, seal, and whale shows here daily. And they have the most well-trained killer whale or orca that I've ever seen anywhere. You also find the botanical gardens at Ocean Park. And from Ocean Park, you get a very good view of Aberdeen Fishing Village. But this is what Aberdeen looked like about 12 years earlier. Notice that barren hillside in the background without a building on it. Well, now, just over a decade later, that hillside looks this way. None of those buildings were there 12 years ago. I wasn't to return to Hong Kong for another 6 months, but when I did come back, I was determined to get off of Hong Kong Island, visit some of the neighboring islands, and eventually to get up into southern China, an area called Guilin. The Chinese will tell you that Guilin is the most beautiful part of their country. This would be our goal for the next trip. Okay, so now I've spent about 12 years traveling through Hong Kong, and I'd never really seen much of anything but Hong Kong. I hadn't seen most of the outer islands, and I hadn't been able to get up into southern China, to that area known as Guilin, which is the subject of Chinese paintings, with limestone peaks coming up out of the water, shrouded in mist, little temples, supposedly the most beautiful part of China. This is going to be our goal for the next part of the journey here. And since I was going to be doing so much traveling, I didn't want to do it by myself. This is a good friend of mine named Bill Moore. He works on a little restaurant called the Boathouse on the Santa Monica Pier. I live just outside that window there on the beach. Well, Bill is an ex-soccer player who's interested in getting into the import-export business, so he's going to accompany me on this next part of the journey. A day or so later, we were back in Hong Kong, and this time we decided to take up residence on the Kowloon Peninsula just across the harbor there, a place where you could find less expensive lodging. The Peninsula Hotel, the Grand Hotel of Kowloon. This hotel has been a home for princes, presidents, prime ministers, kings, queens, and ambassadors from every country. It's expensive here, but if you're looking for true luxury, try the Peninsula. Just down the road from the Peninsula Hotel is the Sheraton, with the most impressive lobby I've ever seen. Actually, the hotels that I saw here and over on Hong Kong were the most luxurious I've ever seen anywhere. But Bill and I were living on a shoestring, so we took up residence in the Chung King Mansion. Here's the Chung King Mansion. A guest house, actually. We're going to be living with this Chinese family in their spare room. That's one of the ways some of the people make a living here. They rent out their spare rooms to travelers on a budget. And two guys as big as Bill and me had an interesting time in a room this small. We had an impressive view from up here on the 12th floor of the streets of Kowloon. But as small as this room was, it was immaculately clean, only $25. They even gave us a color TV. Down in the lobby of the Chung King Mansion, there's sort of a bargain basement mini mall. Well, early in the morning, many of the elderly Chinese participate in a very interesting exercise ceremony. Here's the chin flick. The neck roll. The face rub and the lower arm swing. Now, these exercises are designed to not get anybody too tired. Here's the upper hand clap, the belly rub, and sort of a variation on push-ups. The shoulder roll, but by far my favorite movement of all was this one. Yeah, he's got to loosen up that old tush. Stanley Market, on the southern tip of Hong Kong. Now, Bill knew that I was going to be dragging him off Hong Kong to the neighboring islands and eventually up into China, so he told me that he needed at least one day to go shopping. He told me that he had to buy something for everybody he had ever met. And I think he did that day at Stanley Market. Hong Kong has always been a place that was known for its bargains. Up until a few years ago, you could get a hand-tailored silk suit for just over $25. Well, those days are over now, but you can still get pretty good buys in jade, tea, silk, porcelain, precious stones, precious metals, and ivory until it became illegal on the world market a few years ago. You can get things here for about half the price that they'll cost you on the other side of the island. Bill got some good buys that day. I saw him buy 12 silk ties for a dollar each. There are many of these stalls. Some of the stores actually have roofs on them, but most of them are open to the sky. So some of the smarter ladies bring umbrellas along in case it rains. Well, after a day of shopping at Stanley Market, the next day, Bill and I climbed on one of the large ferries and took off to explore some of the neighboring islands here. We were on our way to the tiny island of Chung Chow. There's really only one community on Chung Chow, another fishing village. The ferry service here is very impressive. The ferry boats are big, comfortable, food served on board, of course, and they travel every hour on the hour from Hong Kong to all the neighboring islands. Getting around this area is very easy to do. Well, since it's a fishing village, once again we had to wind our way between the fishing boats before we could dock. Now, even though Chung Chow is a much smaller community than Hong Kong, it's much older. This was a thriving community when Hong Kong was nothing but a barren rock. And Chung Chow has become a very popular place for artists. International artists from all over the world will rent the little apartments that dot the hillside here. The artists say that Chung Chow is a very inspirational place for an artist to live and work. You can see their point. It's also an education center. When school lets out, you can see a sea of white uniforms coming at you from the one big Buddhist college here. But it's also an education center for every grade level. Children from the neighboring islands and other communities will come into Chung Chow during the day, on the family sampan or in one of the big ferries. She'll spend all day long in school and then she'll take a night boat back home. Bill and my favorite thing about Chung Chow were the outdoor restaurants with a very impressive seafood menu. You just choose whatever you want from one of these tanks. They'll catch it for you, cook it up, and a few minutes later it'll be served very fresh. The restaurants are all outdoors. They're very inexpensive and very good. The Chinese stay in constant contact with their relatives, their dead relatives. This is a Chinese funeral here. The Chinese believe that when you die, you sort of become a god unto yourself, and you have a lot of power, magical power, over the people still living, specifically over the luck of the living. So the Chinese will stay in constant contact with their relatives, praying to them to please watch out for our luck back here on the planet. And the elderly in China are treated very well, primarily due to the things that Confucius taught. Confucius taught that the elderly brought you into this world, and so they deserve a comfortable way out. It's very rare in this part of the world to find the elderly living anywhere but with the family. Most of them stay with their families until the end. Well, after an afternoon on Chung Chow, Bill and I boarded one of the big ferries headed for Lantau. Lantau is the largest island out here, and it was going to be our new home and base of operations for the rest of this story. Lantau is enormous, more than twice as big as Hong Kong, but with a fraction of the population. As you can see, Lantau is more than twice as big as the island of Hong Kong. When Bill and I first arrived on Lantau, we went to the community of Mui Wo, the largest town on this island, although not very large. And when we first arrived, we had our second lunch of the day. Bill and I were eating 5 and 6 meals a day here. That Chinese food just didn't stick with us. While we were waiting for lunch to be served, we were watching fishermen out in the water, catching lunch that might be served to other people in an hour or so. The fishing and restaurant community here are very interdependent. Many of the big lunch boats from Hong Kong will come into Muiwo every day to stock up on fresh fish. Now he's been out all morning long catching eels. Finally, he's ready for a sale. Now he and the restaurant owner will establish the price right over the rail as they make their deal daily here. The price changes daily due to supply and demand. But this supplies all the restaurants with very fresh eels every day. Delicious. They served us sort of a seafood bouillabaisse that day. We didn't ask what was in it, but it was very good. And after eating, Bill and I decided to take a little walk and explore this village, and Muiwo was beautiful. There was a little path leading around that point, so Bill and I decided to take a hike. Being here with Bill was like being in China with John Wayne. He wore that hat everywhere, and the Chinese would point and say, "Oh, you American cowboy." Some of the beaches here were without a footprint. And the water was about 75 degrees. It's amazing when I think of the fact that the hustle and bustle of Hong Kong was only about an hour away on a slow-moving ferry. Someday, after the Chinese really become established here, Muiwo might become another version of Waikiki. It has everything necessary for a beautiful beach resort. But at least for today, Muiwo still looks like this. After I finished this film, I showed it to Bill, and he said, "Rick, you sure do see a whole lot of my back in this movie." Well, it was getting late in the day, and it was time for us to find a place to live. There are only two hotels on the beach in Muiwo, a small one and a smaller one. Bill and I decided to take up residence in the smaller one, a charming little place called the Muiwo Inn, a family-owned and run operation. When Bill and I first arrived here, we met the two dogs of the building. We called them Mama Dog and Papa Dog. Here's Mama Dog. They're good watchdogs. When Bill and I first arrived, they growled at us, but then they watched us check in and put our luggage in our room, and from then on, they became our dogs. They were very good watchdogs, though. For example, that little black dog doesn't belong inside the wall here. Watch Mama Dog and Papa Dog take care of business. Every morning, the water was as smooth as glass with a mist, and the fishermen would be out there for their morning catch. Some of the fishermen here have three catches a day. They'll go out in the morning for their morning catch, sell those fish at about lunchtime. Then they'll go out in the afternoon for their afternoon catch, sell those fish at about dinner time, and some of them will go out for an evening catch, sell those fish the next morning. Well, this was the day that Bill and I decided to start exploring this large island. So after eating breakfast, we hopped on a bus that was going up the largest mountain on the island. On the top of this mountain, you could find the Polin Monastery, a Buddhist temple. And the Polin Monastery is where you find the largest statue of the Buddha to be found anywhere in the world. There's a very serene feeling in a Buddhist temple. Buddhism is one of the three faiths in China. And these people are practicing Tai Chi, a Chinese art form designed to create harmony between the physical body and the spiritual soul. Many Chinese practice Tai Chi every morning. The story of the Buddha was really very much like the story of Moses. He was born a wealthy Hindu prince about 2,500 years ago near the border between Nepal and India. His name was Guityama Sedartha. And like many princes of his time, he was born and raised, even married and started a family, all within the confines of one palace, never seeing the outside world. One day, however, Sedartha did walk outside, and for the first time in his life, he saw the horrible condition that the world was really in. He was so moved by this that he renounced all of his worldly possessions and spent many years traveling around as a merchant and a beggar, seeing the world from that point of view. One day he sat down underneath a Bodhi tree and meditated and fasted for 49 days. Finally, under a full moon, he attained nirvana. Basically, this means he received enlightenment. He decided that the main problem with people was greed, people wanting what they couldn't have or wanting what their brothers had. He figured if he could divorce himself from this problem, he'd have taken the first step in cleaning up the human condition. He spent the rest of his life traveling and teaching this, became the basis of the Buddhist faith. Now, I have many very cute children in this movie, but in my opinion, she's the cutest. She seemed to have a little motor inside of her. First, she'd play this finger game for a moment or so, but then that motor would kick in, she'd start bouncing and have to take a run. Then she'd stop again, play the finger game. Watch her notice my big movie camera here in a moment. Hi. That motor's going to kick in pretty soon, though. She's not going to be able to stay still for long. She's going to have to start bouncing and take a run. Every evening, there was a serene pastel sunset in Muiwo. And then every morning, the water would be as smooth as glass, and the fishermen would be out there in the mist for their morning catch. This unchanging pattern that's gone on for who knows how long. Now, this guy's not catching fish for people to eat. He's catching fish for fish to eat. He's a bait fisherman and an expert net thrower. Now, that net is weighted. It'll sink to the bottom, trapping all the tiny fish below. The fishing community here is very interdependent. The hungry people depend on the restaurants depend on the fishermen, and the fishermen depend on the bait fishermen. At first, though, I thought he was a poor fisherman. He seemed to be coming up with an empty net, until I realized that he was actually taking the fish out of the net underwater and keeping them in a container on the bottom. Then he would come out and untangle his net for the next throw. Today was the day for a hike. The best hiking trails are on Lantau because it's so big, and the best hike, in my opinion, starts at a very interesting place, behind the only one big prison here. With the densest population anywhere, you do have lawbreakers, and you have to have a place to keep them, but they don't punish people like this anymore. And up in the hill behind this prison begins a trail that will lead you from the dry side of the island around to the wet side. Each of these islands has a dry side and a wet side. Just before Bill and I began the hike, three butterflies put on an interesting show for my camera. What kind of butterflies are they? Chinese butterflies. Well, the first part of this hike was actually very easy, a wide paved hiking trail. We got a map of the hiking trails, and on the map, this trail looked like it was about 6 or 7 miles long. Well, the map was wrong. It was about 12 miles long, up and down hills, in the tropics, in the summer. Bill and I only brought one bottle of water along, and that was gone in the first hour. The dry side of Lantau reminded me very much of the Big Sur coastline in Northern California. But once we got around that point, we were in a dense tropical rainforest. Bill and I only saw two abandoned villages along this whole trail. And the only person that we saw the whole day was a little old Chinese lady who lived in one of these empty villages. She said she liked the solitude out here. There she is. She told us that her relatives brought food out to her once a week. Here's a banana forest. There's a banana blossom. This is a much more difficult hike than I'm showing you, but toward the end of the afternoon, we did manage to arrive in Teo, the second largest community on Lantau. Much different than Muiwo, though. Teo hasn't really changed much in the last century. Another fishing village. Teo specializes in dried fish. The main staple of the Chinese diet is fish and rice, and many of the Chinese families come out here once a week to stock up on dried fish from Teo. Things I saw in Teo reminded me of scenes conjured from a James Clavell novel. The whole place looked like an oil painting. We liked this guy a lot. We stayed there for about a half hour and talked to him. Interesting, since we didn't speak Chinese and he didn't speak any English. Part of Teo is separated from the main community by this little channel of water. So to get across, you have to pay the raft pullers 50 cents. 50 cents Hong Kong is about 10 cents US. The police are always on patrol here. With the densest population anywhere in the world, you have to have a lot of police. But they do, and they always seem to be around. They do a very good job. Well, everybody worked long into the evening. That's because tomorrow was Saturday. Saturday and Sunday, all the people come out here, and the people of Teo make most of their money on the weekend. Notice how many people there are on those two rafts being pulled across the next morning. At 50 cents a head, the raft pullers can make enough money on the weekend to take them through the whole week. We had to get back to Muiwo. The first typhoon of typhoon season was approaching. These typhoons cause a lot of damage here every year. In the last century, 2,000 people were killed in six terrible hours during one of them. When these typhoons hit, they hit like a hammer. They throw ships around like corks. And this one hit very quickly. Bill and I didn't even have time to walk the mile back to the Muiwo Inn. We actually got trapped at the ferry dock while we waited for the first part of the storm to pass. The center winds got close to 100 miles an hour. And after about 3 hours, something interesting happened. The skies cleared a bit, the wind subsided, and we were actually in the eye of the typhoon. These typhoons have a circular eye in the center. They gave us a chance to walk back to the Muiwo Inn, which was a mess. Well, you're really only in the eye of a typhoon for 20 or 30 minutes or so, so there was no real time to clean up. Mama Dog has seen this many times. The lifeguards decided that this was a good opportunity to go windsurfing in the eye of a typhoon. Typhoons and hurricanes are exactly the same kind of storm. The only difference is that typhoon is a Chinese word and hurricane is a European word. So they refer to the same type of storm, only in different parts of the world. There's the second part of the typhoon approaching, with the wind going in opposite direction, possibly even faster than the first time. So as the wind got stronger, the skies got darker, and the windsurfers went faster and faster. Bill and I were realizing that they were actually in competition out there with each other. Each one wanted to be the last one to come in before the second part of the typhoon struck. Sort of an athletic point of honor. And when the second part of the typhoon hit, it hit even harder than the first. The winds got up well over 100 miles an hour. Tore Muiwo to pieces. But after about 6 hours in all, the typhoon passed, and this community was a mess. The sidewalks had been destroyed by the big waves, the plumbing was out of commission, and the outdoor restaurants had been shredded. Cleaning up after a typhoon is nothing new to these people. They go through about a half a dozen of these a year. First, the fallen trees have to be sawed up and carted away. And some of the trees hadn't actually fallen, but their branches had been snapped like twigs. And styrofoam everywhere. I think all the styrofoam in Hong Kong ended up on the beach here in Mui Wo. Packs of hungry dogs out looking for something to eat after the storm. The lifeguard started to clean everything up, and Mui Wo got back to normal in a very short period of time. The Mui Wo Inn hadn't really sustained too much damage. All the potted plants had been blown over, but these people really know how to prepare for these storms. As soon as the water was calm enough, the fishermen were out there for their afternoon catch. That sailboard had been destroyed in the waves. I wondered if the surfer got ashore safely. The only real damage to the Mui Wo Inn was a few broken windows, and one of the signs up there on the roof had been blown away. There was an interesting sunset that evening. There had been a fire started back in Hong Kong by the storm, and the sky was filled with smoke that night, creating this red sunset. The next morning, we were to begin our journey up into southern China, so we caught the first ferry that morning into Hong Kong. Now, Hong Kong had been damaged by the storm, but not as much as Mui Wo. Remember, Hong Kong is protected by that S-shaped Victoria Harbor. Back on Lantau, we had been right in the path of the storm. We caught a subway under the harbor to a boat that was going to take us part of the way up the enormous Pearl River, one of the ancient routes up into China. Also the route that the Taipan traders had to take in the last century to acquire their goods. This was also the first leg of the journey to a place called Guilin, the place that had inspired some of the most beautiful paintings that I had ever seen. I couldn't imagine that there was actually a place that looked like this, but there is. We are going to have to cross through quite a bit of China before we reach Guilin, though. First, we have to cross the border from the new territories into China. These border crossings have changed quite a bit in the last few years, as you can see. But we'll cross this border, we'll go through customs and immigration, then we'll board a train, heading about 90 miles north of Hong Kong to the city of Guangzhou in the Canton province. The whole 90-mile trip seemed to be farmland. The most densely populated country in the world seemed to have quite a few people working very hard. As we entered Guangzhou, we saw some interesting architecture and building everywhere. There was wooden scaffolding everywhere. China is going through quite a building boom these days. Guangzhou is an enormous city and an ancient city, but with some very modern areas. And more bicycles than I've ever seen in my life. In a country like China, most people can't afford a car or a truck, but almost everybody can afford a bicycle, and I think almost everybody has one. And naturally, if you have this many bikes, you have to have bicycle parking lots with paid attendants to watch your bike. Now, Guangzhou in the Canton province is where the Taipan traders had to come in the last century to acquire tea, silk, and porcelain. Now, this was a very lucrative endeavor, but also a very dangerous one. Many of the Taipans made a fortune in one year, lost their lives the next. That's the main reason they needed Hong Kong Island. They wanted to get out from under this very dangerous way of doing business. The British had become very addicted to Chinese tea, but the Chinese trade merchants were imposing very strict and expensive trade rules. The British needed their own colony. Hong Kong foot the bill. Now here's a scene that might shock a few people. If you've ever visited a Chinese market, you might know what's coming. I was told that if it ever lived, the Chinese will eat it. Now, most people in the world eat fish, so this isn't too uncommon. We've all seen sights like this. Most people in the world eat poultry. Ducks, geese, turkeys, chickens. So this isn't too unusual either. Even though we very rarely see it displayed this way in the West. Many people in the world eat rabbit, but you never find them live in the markets here. But in China and the rest of the Third World, refrigeration is either very primitive or non-existent, so freshness is very important. You can't get much fresher than alive. Many people here like lamb, but you never see it displayed quite this way in our country. Most people in the world don't eat dogs, but they do in China, so you can find them hanging right here in the marketplace. Fewer people in the world than eat dogs eat rats. Filleted rats. Delicious. Swamp eels, very fresh. This is as shocking as it's going to get. But I guarantee if you ever visit a Chinese market, the sights that you see and the smells that you smell, you will never forget for the rest of your life. Guaranteed. As I was looking down the windy little narrow roads of Guangzhou, again I was thinking about the last century when the Taipan traders would come up here and risk their own life to try and make their fortunes. There's no such thing as too many on a motorcycle in these cities. If you ever get an opportunity to drive in a Chinese city, don't. Don't even think about it. The traffic situations are horrendous. We're on our way to a jade factory. Jade is a beautiful greenish translucent mineral, and the best jade and the best jade work comes from southern China. This is an art that's handed down from father to son, generation after generation. By the time you're a teenager in a jade family, you're turning out works of art like this. And I found that I could buy these things very inexpensively by coming all the way to the source here. I bought a figurine about this size for $50. I saw the same figurine back in Santa Monica for $450. Tomorrow is to begin the rest of our journey to Guilin. So early in the morning, we boarded a train heading north more than 300 miles. Now, the train ride from Guangzhou to Guilin is a long one because sometimes that train travels very slowly. But there's constantly food being served on board, and it was a very comfortable and interesting trip through some very primitive territory. We arrived in Guilin the next morning even before the sun came up. The community was still asleep, but limestone peaks were jutting up everywhere. There was a pathway leading to the top of one of the peaks, a place where I could shoot this scene of the sleeping community. I was also now beginning to realize that all the movies I'd been making over the last 20 years had their roots here. The people who populated places like Thailand, Indonesia, Malaysia, Singapore, had all come from southern China, fleeing the hordes of Kublai Khan and other conquerors. So really the roots of all my other stories began right here. And under this particular limestone peak, there was a cave. Inside that cave was a Buddhist shrine. The carvings on the wall in here are more than 800 years old. Primarily, what Siddhartha the Buddha taught was that people should be satisfied with their lot in life. In other words, if you're a rich man but unhappy, you're not really rich at all. And if you're a poor man but satisfied with your family or something else, you're really rich. Live with the hand God dealt you and do the best that you can. That's the main philosophy of the Buddhist faith. They call this formation the elephant's trunk. Looked a little bit like an elephant's trunk. But not anywhere near as much as the camel looks like a camel. How could this ever be called anything but the camel? One of the reasons that the traffic situation is so horrendous here is that there are no lines painted on any of the roads, so very few people pay any attention to anything like lanes.
and there's always more foot and bicycle traffic on the roads than any motorized vehicles. We're on our way out here to the beautiful Lejiang River, also called the Lee River, for a beautiful boat ride through the most spectacular part of China. After we got out of town, the traffic changed a little bit. These are water buffalo, the backbone of farm life here. Now these are lunch boats, big lunch boats. We're going to be traveling on a fleet of about 50 of these for about 25 miles upriver through the most beautiful area I've ever seen. These boats are very big, but they're flat-bottomed. So fully loaded, they can travel on very shallow water. They only need just over 3 feet. I had been told that millions of years ago, this was a flat surface. But then very much in the same way that the Grand Canyon was dug by the Colorado River, the Lee River dug this canyon. Millions and millions of years washed away the dirt, leaving these limestone peaks standing. Here's the main way of getting around this river for most people, these little rafts. Actually, they're just 5 pieces of bamboo lashed together with a basket in the middle and 2 people rowing. And they really seem to fit in here. Imagine what it would be like living on a river like this. What a spiritual existence that could be. The Chinese will tell you that their most famous landmark is the Great Wall, and the most beautiful part of their country is Guilin and the Lejiang River. And there's our fleet. Even this many big boats doesn't seem to disturb the natural beauty and serenity of this place. The galley staff in the stern of our boat was preparing lunch for us as we cruised upriver. Soon we were served a delicious seafood lunch that we were able to eat while cruising through this spectacular countryside. Some of these smaller lunch boats will actually land and let you take a hike. They don't serve hot lunches on board, the lunches are cold, but you do get to take a walk and explore. And here's the flag of the People's Republic of China. And as amazing as it seemed, the farther upstream we got, the scenery even became more spectacular. And there really was a place in the world that looked like those paintings that I had seen. You know, I can think of no way that the Chinese philosophy of life was better expressed than by Louza. If you'll remember, he was the prophet of the Tao. And before he took off toward Tibet on his water buffalo seeking solitude, one of his followers asked him to write something down so they would have something to study and worship. Louza wrote this. He said there is a being, wonderful, perfect. It existed before heaven and earth. How quiet it is, how spiritual it is. It stands alone and does not change. It moves around and around, but does not on that account suffer. All life comes from it. It wraps everything with its love as in a garment. Yet it claims no honor and does not demand to be Lord. I do not know its name, so I call it Tao, the way, and I rejoice in its power. Sounds like a pretty good description of God to me. Finally, we were nearing the end of the voyage upstream, and it was time to unload the boats, one at a time. I had thought possibly of making this the last scene in the movie. I didn't know then that we were going to be treated to a very beautiful dance recital that night. But still, the Lejiang River had provided everything I had ever hoped from it. After we got back to town, we spent the rest of the afternoon relaxing in our hotel, waiting for the sun to go down behind the limestone peaks in the west. That evening, we traveled a little ways across town to one of the larger hotels where dance troupes from all over northern and southern China had come together to perform. The Chinese dances all tell stories. The dancers are always accompanied by a little musical group just off stage. Now this dance tells a story of Chinese farm life, young people meeting, falling in love, getting married, raising crops and children. Normal human values that people all over the world can relate to. You know, I was raised during something called the Cold War. I was told to be afraid of the communists, they're evil. Watch out for the Russians and the Chinese, they're out to conquer the world. Well, that's not exactly what Bill and I found here. On the contrary, we were treated as honored guests. We were never made to feel uncomfortable or threatened in any way. If there was one message I could get across here, I would like it to be, never judge the people of a place by the actions and decisions that their government sometimes make. I know, for example, that the Chinese never won another Tiananmen Square, just as the Americans never won another Vietnam. There's no reason anybody in the world should be starving. There's plenty of food for everybody, and we have the technology necessary to deliver it. But we're not there yet. I don't believe that there's an evil empire anywhere in the world. There's obviously evil in every empire, and you can find it if you look for it. Actually, it's necessary to be aware of it because sometimes it comes looking for us. But it's much easier to find the good in people. That just jumps right out at you. And think about what's actually happening here. For the first time in history, something as valuable as Hong Kong is peacefully changing hands between the British and the Chinese. And the Chinese have decided to leave the British in charge of most of their businesses for another 50 years. In other words, they're working it out. It's true that the bad things about human behavior usually make the news, but the good in us can save us, and it's about time we start paying more attention to that. This old world is getting a little bit too small for us to go on in some of the ways that we have been. But if the way that the Chinese treated Bill and me is any indication of the future, we're all going to be okay for quite a while. I was very happy that before leaving, we got one more chance to see one of these Kung Fu spear dancers in action. You know, the thing that I could never understand is, how do you train for this? I mean, obviously he's a master, but how did he practice this before he really knew what he was doing? Soon he was joined by a partner, and their dance even became more impressive. At the end of the evening, they even managed to get Bill up there on stage with them. It seemed very fitting that these were our last few days in China. When we got back to Hong Kong, the decorations from Chinese New Year's were still up. Well, I decided to leave you with this last image of Hong Kong. So from Bill and me and all the Chinese, thanks for traveling with us, and I'll see you again next time.